and join us as we worship him and sing his praises.
Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The Word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved me.
where many a dream has died. Like a tree planted by the water, we never will run dry. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire, just to know. To show them who you are. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire, just to
that they were letting the children make in the craft time. And just to see them sitting there with the Bible and sharing the gospel presentation to other children was just awesome.
Well, I think to talk about really how it was, we'll ask the young ones there, because we had the honor, I think, of having the oldest folks there and the youngest folks there. because. Okay, you want to say something, Calvin?
It was great. It was great helping people, and there was a lot of poor people there, but we helped them getting food and everything that they needed.
It was amazing to help the community. We did a food pantry, and it was just amazing.
Well, my favorite part was just going to the nursing home and just helping the elderly with just painting nails and letting them have a good time.
Well, my favorite part was being with my grandchildren, to be honest with you, and seeing the work that they were doing and sharing their Christ throughout the community with everybody they came in contact with, both at the block party, at the nursing home. I could stand here and talk forever about the different experiences and the many blessings that was given to me. You know, you go and expect to give blessings to others, but in turn you get the blessings. So it was a great trip.
I'm going to speak on behalf of our youngest grandchild who lives in Pennsylvania. She had a precious spirit the whole time we were out there. We went canvassing one day and she told me that was the creepiest place she'd ever been. But she was brave, and she went to the door. She knocked on doors, as did this child, and they all, I was just shocked that these children were as evangelistic as they are. They just went out and did everything. They washed cars. They ran the block party. You think the teenagers can run a block? These children can run a block party because they did it. She worked snow cones for like 4 hours, as did Amber Lee. And so, I mean, I don't know what the others did. And my littlest one painted faces. You saw the pastor, and he was smiling with balloons in his hands. Well, she painted him up with, looked like a tiger. So they just, the children had just a great serving spirit. So, and that's why we took them, is to teach them that there's a place other than where they live, and there are hearts other than just the hearts in this community.
Yeah, we really enjoyed this trip. We thank you here at Kingsland for your prayers and your support, and we're thankful to be back home, but we really enjoyed it. And I think, like everyone else has said, seeing the children serve was really what the trip is about. It's families on mission, and you know, it was six of us adults and I think seven grandchildren. And so it was awesome to see them work and serve. And just for me personally, I think the thing that touched me the most was when we went to Coburn to help with the food pantry there. It's pretty amazing. We were talking to the pastor. They feed 450 families a month, and Coburn only has 2,000 people, so you can kind of do the math. It's pretty poor. It's a lot of hungry people. And they do an amazing job with that ministry. And we brought all this food in and helped them sort it and everything for the following day for the families to come in and get the food. And the pastor said, "You think this looks like a lot of food, right?" And we said, "Yeah, it looks like a lot of food." He said, "Tomorrow afternoon, this room will be empty. We start all over again." So that's an eye-opener. We have a lot to be thankful for. And so anyway, that's all I had to say to you. Praise the Lord.
It was great helping people.
I think the kids have really summed it up. It was a wonderful, wonderful family event. And the grown-ups talked about it. We were all grandparents bringing our grandchildren. So it doesn't just have to be the parents and their kids. It can be all kinds of family members. And we did touch some lives, and I think we had certainly some folks that did accept the Lord or strongly had a seed planted. But I think for us, it was such a blessing, and hopefully we can do it again real soon.
And to sum it up, on that Friday when we left, none of the kids wanted to leave. And in fact, when we got home, this one cried herself to sleep that night because we left.
Like I said, our granddaughters couldn't be here today, but Eliza wrote a little letter. I thought that the mission trip was awesome. The Bible school was great, and I think a lot of kids learned about God. All the missions we did were very fun. I hope more and more people come work at missions each year. I guarantee they'll love it. Most importantly, it'll bring you closer to God. Sincerely, Eliza. We want to see you all next year.
Well, praise God. That's just to show that you can never be too young or too experienced to participate in these trips. I encourage you, please get involved. Pray for them. Talk to them and get some more information about hopefully next year's trip as well. Let's stand as we continue to worship. Father God, we love you. We praise you. We sing to your majesty right now. We sing Hosanna. We cry out to you, God. We seek your face. We ask for your intervention in our lives, our struggles, the hard times we have, God. We know that you're in control. We long to see your face and your hand in our life for your glory. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's sing.
See the King of Glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes. I see his love and mercy washing over all our sins. The people sing, Hosanna.
pray with me. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come today to worship you, an almighty God, a God who loves us as we love him, allow us to give these tithes and offerings, those that have been granted to us by the talents you have given us, Lord, through our work. Guide us and direct us. Take this offering for your work throughout, to build your kingdom throughout our community, throughout the world. In your heavenly name, amen.
Welcome to Abe's Honest Pizza Palace. We'll get your pizza there in a zap.
Access granted. Abe's Honest Pizza Palace. Average ingredients, terrible pizza. The secret to their success lies in a hidden room.
Welcome to Agency D3. An organization comprised of highly skilled operatives committed to discovering, deciding, and defending the truth about Jesus. Our operatives are the best of the best, but we need your help. We're setting up recruitment stations all across the world, looking for agents, looking for you.
Sir, Rocket Pack Jack is under attack.
How are we looking, Jack?
Nothing I can't handle, Chief. Keep me posted.
At Agency D3, cadets will be trained to answer the most important question. Who is Jesus? Cadets report each day to headquarters for worship briefing.
Decide and defend the truth about Jesus. So if you know any children, bring them tonight. Sign up in the foyer, online, or you can sign up tonight when you come to the door. We're going to be pressing t-shirts all week. It is going to be a lot of fun. We hope to see you there.
Thank you, Christy Wants. Thank you, VBS team, that's already put a ton of work into preparing for this thing tonight on this stage. It is going to be a ton of fun. I hope that you will be here. Bring your kids, bring your grandkids. If you would open up your bulletins, before we open up the Word of God, let's do this. Let's take care of business real quick. So we have so much going on. You have a very attractive Agency D3 flyer to pass out to your friends and family today. Do you know the most influential time, the most productive time to invite somebody to a church event is just a few hours before the event happens? Some people did that for the Bible Club in our neighborhood this week, and all three of our kids went every night and loved it. We can do this. Take a flyer out, invite your neighbors and your friends. Offer to bring them in with you. There is a VBS meeting right after church. Did you mention that? Was I not paying attention? Anyway, there's a VBS meeting right here up front after church. So please come, those of you that are working in it. And if you haven't already got your shirt, come, be ready. The buses will go out early. If you want to help with the buses, we can always use help with that. Again, even knocking on some doors and some of these kids that live in the neighborhood that we're picking up, we need help with that. So there's a place for everybody. Pray for Vacation Bible School. Participate in it. This is when people get saved. This is when little lives get changed. And this is what we are all about. So in addition to that, if your bulletin's already open, thank you, visitors. Notice a few new faces here today. Thank you, all of you that are here visiting with us. You are important to us. Fill out that little information card there, and we'll correspond with you through that. We'd love to get to know you better. You'll find out a little bit more about Crossover Baltimore at the end of the service today, but that's Saturday. That's just Saturday. So we have a ton of stuff going on. After that, we will go and visit all of the people who came, the families of the kids who come to Vacation Bible School. So there are lots and lots of good options for you to serve. There's no home groups Wednesday night because of Vacation Bible School, so be aware of that. Turn in your Bibles over to the book of Ephesians, and we are talking about connected, my life in the church. This is a series we started here recently, studying the book of Ephesians, which you can't see the banners anymore, but that's what we're doing. We're studying the book of Ephesians this summer, and on Wednesday nights, the connected groups are meeting. I'm extremely thankful to announce to you, after hearing back from all of our leaders Wednesday night, we have over 100 people meeting in our small groups on Wednesday nights, which is nothing short of a miracle. Thank all of you that are participating. It's not too late to go ahead and get involved. There's one here at the church, not this Wednesday, but it'll kick back up again next Wednesday. You can come to that, and you can look at the bulletin on the other ones you can go to. The McLarens, the Calabreses, and the Rice have plenty of room still at theirs if you're looking for one to go to. So please get connected. That's the whole point of Ephesians, was that Jews and Gentiles got connected in something called the church. It was a mystery. It was something that they didn't know about before Paul explained it to them in the book of Ephesians, in this letter to Ephesus that breaks down into three and three. Three doctrinal chapters, three duty chapters. You got to be careful how you say that word, duty. Duty, D-U-T-Y, duty. It's a word people don't know much about anymore around here. Not around here, in our culture. Duty, how to live your life. Doctrine, how to think, how to believe. That's what we're kind of studying today. In fact, today is really just two words, grace and redemption. Grace and redemption. The title of my message is grace, G-R-A-C-E, grace. God's riches at Christ's expense. Everybody needs grace. We need to extend a little grace, right? Every one of us need a little grace once in a while. And everyone really needs G-R-A-C-E, say it with me, God's riches at Christ's expense. I didn't make that up, just in case anybody is filing any copyright lawsuits or anything. I didn't come up with that. But the passage you're going to read today makes it very clear that we are rich, we are wealthy in Christ because of his grace, because God gave us everything we needed through the cross, through the resurrection. We've sang about it this morning. Thank all of you for singing. Thank all of you for being here today. It's summertime. I'm so thankful when people come to church. It's good to see you. We're going to have some fun studying the word grace and the word redemption. In fact, if you really want to get theological about it, this is really the study of, in theological terms, soteriology. That's the doctrine of salvation. Soteriology. And it's important. It's at the core of everything we believe. Do you work for it? No. Do you pay money for it? No, although, let's face it, we're a little behind budget. Thank you, all of you who put money in the offering plate. We need it. This church has a great vision and a great mission that can only be accomplished by all of us giving sacrificially. You need to give. Put your money where your mouth is. But that you can't buy heaven. You can't buy redemption. You can't buy grace. It is a free gift. Now, I bet a lot of you know that from Ephesians chapter 2, for by grace you're saved, through faith. But when it comes to this letter to Ephesus, we're given tremendous resources and we're given insight to it in this book. This is 10 years after Paul has established the church in Ephesus. He's writing back to them. And Aquila and Priscilla are running that house church in Ephesus, and he's giving them some wisdom. He's giving them some insight to help better understand the God who chose them, adopted them, accepted them, predestined them. That's how far we've gotten so far. In fact, we're going to go ahead and read those verses again to kind of set the context. We're really only going to do two verses today. And what we see is that he explains how we've been saved here, how we've been changed, how we've been connected to Christ and to one another. We have been adopted, so we're richly blessed, given everything we need by our Father, the King of Kings. Think about that as we read these first eight verses, okay? Are you ready? Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, to the saints who are in Ephesus and are faithful in Christ, grace and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I've already preached this thing twice in the last two times we were together. I'm not going to do it again. I just want to say this today. Grace and peace. I wish you, I hope that you, I can't give it to you, but as best I can as a communicator, as a delivery boy, as a newspaper boy, that's all I am. That's what I was 20 years ago in Chattanooga, throwing the paper. That's all I'm doing today. I'm delivering the news to you. Peace. I hope that you, shalom, the old Hebrew word. I hope that you have peace. And if you came in these doors today without peace, we're talking about redemption. For the whole week that I've been preparing this message, I've been thinking about the word replaced. Redemption versus replaced or abandoned. Some of you need redemption in the sense of being born again and being saved. Others of you are saved, but you need to be purchased back. You need to be redeemed in the sense you need the peace that only comes through a relationship with Christ that you already have but that you're ignoring. Maybe you've been replaced. I don't know why that's been on my mind a lot this week, but people that have been replaced. You know, we live in fear of being replaced. What I mean by that is, you know, spouses that are living in fear of being replaced by another spouse, and some of you have been, and you know exactly what that's like, or a pastor being replaced by another pastor, or whatever you do for a living. It has to go through your mind once in a while that someone could replace you. Or kids that grow up in homes and dad's gone or mom's gone and they feel like they've been replaced. Are you following what I'm saying? Maybe abandoned. If that's you today, I just want you to know God loves you. And what we're reading here is how you can have peace even though terrible things have happened to you. Even though maybe you've been abandoned or replaced. Is there anything worse than getting replaced? That's a humiliating, horrifying thing. But to the one or two or ten or maybe a couple dozen of you that feel it and know what I'm talking about, man, it hits close to home, and you can relate to it. And if I could just somehow communicate this word to you, grace, we're going to talk a lot about today, but over the last few weeks, and peace. It's not just a greeting. It's not just a salutation. I pray that you will experience peace in your life. From understanding that no matter how many times you've been abandoned or how many times you've been replaced or you don't feel that great about yourself, the secular psychology says, well, just tell yourself you're a winner. I'm a winner. I'm a winner. I'm a winner. I'm a winner. And I'm important and I matter. Well, you know, that's fine. Okay. Not really. You know, your value is in the fact that you were created in the image of Almighty God. He accepts you. That's what makes you valuable. And because of that relationship you can have when you've been redeemed, when you receive his grace, you can have peace. That's still review, though. Look at verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him in love. He predestined us for adoption as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace. If you weren't here last week, please get the video or the DVD. And I don't say that every week. I'm not trying to self-promote. I'd like for you to hear what was said last week about being predestined, adopted, accepted, and so forth. It's important. But it's all for God's glory, not yours. He loves us, but let's not get so fixated and so narcissistic that we forget the fact that He first loved us, he called us, and he has a glorious plan for our lives that's all about his glory, not our promotion or us looking good or feeling good about ourselves. It's not what it's all about, is it? And he's blessed us in the beloved. Now, verse 7, this is new. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us, in all wisdom and insight. Now, let's prepare for next week. Let's keep reading. Let's read the rest of the sentence. Making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth, period. I wanted to finish the sentence. We'll get into all that next week. We're going to talk about redemption. In him, we have this thing, redemption. In him, we have this amazing resource, this gift, This awesome thing that sometimes we ignore and we forget about. It's almost like having a rich uncle who you know is going to leave you millions, but you don't really live like it. You ignore it, and you know it's going to happen someday, but you don't live like it, or even have a rich uncle that gave you the millions. Have you ever heard of Hetty Green? Hetty Green is known as America's greatest miser when she died in 1916, 100 years ago, she died. She was also known as the Witch of Wall Street. Who amongst us wouldn't want to be known as that? The Witch of Wall Street. She was a fantastic businesswoman in the days of mostly men on Wall Street. She left behind an estate valued at over $100 million in 1916. $100 million then. Heaven only knows how much that would be in modern terms. But she was cheap. They say she ate cold oatmeal because it cost too much money to heat the oatmeal. Her son had a leg amputated, to get this, because she took too long to get the infection treated, and she kept going to free clinics. But they recognized her, and they wouldn't work on him for free. And by the time she got it worked on, they had to amputate his leg. She was wealthy but chose to live like a pauper. She hastened her own death by not getting the help she needed in her last days. Her stinginess was legendary. She robbed herself and others of great joy. She never utilized the wealth that she acquired. Are you following me? She never tapped into the great resources that she had at her fingertips. In many ways, the book of Ephesians was written to Christians who suffer from the same kind of problem. We have everything we need as sons and daughters of the King of Kings. But do we live like it? Do you feel it? Do I feel like that today? Do we enjoy it the way we should? We have infinite provision through Christ, but sometimes we ignore it. It's as if it's not there. We forget who we are in Christ. This passage reminds us who we are in Christ, and what I'm saying today is, if you've been redeemed, celebrate it, enjoy it, embrace it, and share it. If you've not been redeemed, receive it. In verse 7, in him we have redemption. That's how the verse starts. In him we have redemption. True redemption is only found in a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Not the Virgin Mary, not Allah, not Buddha, not Confucius, or David Koresh, or Joseph Smith, or Sun Myung Moon, or any other religious leader. Now, the simple statement I just made is offensive to some and could literally cost me my head if I lived in certain countries, especially in the Middle East today. But it's true, and it needs to be shared with the 7 billion people who populate our planet. Thank you, WISE mission team, for taking it down to Southwest Virginia. That's pretty cool. The very week they were doing that, we were doing it all over Richmond with the Fusion mission, 310 kids from the SBCV doing it here in Richmond. And why? Because the greatest need people have is to be redeemed. And we used to quote this verse. Does anybody remember faith evangelism? If you were part of faith, raise your hand proudly. You should be. Man, a lot of people. If all of you that did should know this verse, if you memorize it, Ephesians 1:7, let's do it. In him, meaning Jesus, we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. You remember that? In him, meaning Jesus, he's the Savior, he's the Redeemer, everyone else is a fraud, everyone else is a liar. And we need to take this truth. Here's the question. When was the last time you shared that truth with anybody? When was the last time you shared that truth with anybody? We can fight over politics, we can have fun, we can discuss politics, we can discuss sports teams and hobbies and all that, interests. I would just ask you, when was the last time you shared that truth with somebody? That in Jesus, you can have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. You can have your sins forgiven. We need to share that message. That's why we're doing Vacation Bible School this week. It's not too late to get involved. We need all hands on deck. And I got to be honest with you, I'm worried a little bit. Because there's a lot of kids in this community that would come that aren't going to be here because they never got invited. We don't encourage, you know, texting during sermons and Facebook and all that. But you know what? We'll make an exception. If you want to put on your Facebook right now, come to Kingsland, 6 o'clock tonight, Vacation Bible School. Do that. Share it with everybody. Get the event that was made and share it to everybody you have. Or text it or email it or whatever you got to do. It's not too late to invite people to Vacation Bible School. Why? Because we want little ones to know that they can be redeemed. They can be forgiven. That's why we're doing Crossover Part 2 this coming Saturday. That's why we're doing Go Outreach in 2 weeks. Now let's talk about redemption. Warren Wiersbe is one of my favorite authors, and if you can get anything by Warren Wiersbe, do it. Warren Wiersbe said this about redemption. To redeem means to purchase and set free by paying a price. I'm going to slow down because I want to make sure everybody gets that. Redeem, to be redeemed. To redeem means to purchase and set free by paying a price. Wiersbe points out that in this era when Paul was writing, there were 60 million slaves in the Roman Empire, and often a man could purchase a slave and then set him free. That's what Jesus did for us, isn't it? The price was his own blood. Therefore, we are free from the law, Galatians 5:1. We are free from slavery to sin, Romans 6. And we're free from the power of Satan, Galatians 1:4. When we were slaves, we were poor. But because we are now sons of the King of Kings, we're rich. And we're blessed in so many different ways. Do you feel free today? Do you just feel free? You should. You should. If you've been saved, you've been redeemed, which means you've been set free. And if the Son has set you free, you're free indeed. John 8:36. God's grace frees us. So in him, meaning Jesus, we have redemption, the forgiveness of our trespasses or our sins. Now this is interesting. The word forgiveness. The word forgiveness literally means, in the Greek, the word there means to carry away. To carry away. Now, if you're like me and you grew up in church, maybe something comes to mind there. To carry away. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Living, rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, and we just sang, oh, glorious day. Man, how awesome it is to wait for his coming and to plan for his coming and to be prepared for his coming and to realize, man, what a glorious day that's going to be. Between now and then, he lives in me, he lives through me, and he set me free, and he has carried away. Remember in the Old Testament, he threw your sins in the sea of forgetfulness. From the east, as far as from the east is from the west, he carried them away. Now, in the Old Testament, on the Day of Atonement, the high priest would symbolically send the scapegoat out into the wilderness. One goat died, and his blood was sprinkled on another goat who was sent out, and the scapegoat was sent out into the wilderness. They did this over and over each year as a ritual that pointed to something beyond their comprehension. Now, 2,000 years, 4,000 years later, we can look back and we can know exactly what they were symbolizing. It was all about Jesus. Christ died to provide a permanent solution to our sin problem, and he's the ultimate scapegoat. He carried our sins away, never to be mentioned again or brought up against us. Any of you that are having relationship problems of any kind, brother, sister, husband, wife, mom, dad, whatever, man, quit bringing stuff up from the past. Deal with it and be done with it. We know this on a human level, don't we? Nobody likes to have stuff brought up from a year ago or 2 years ago. You're always doing that. Don't say always. Or you never do that. Don't say never. Always and never bad. Man, put the past in the past. Now, I have a child, one of them, doesn't matter which one, that likes to say that to me, like right after they do something. Like, can't we just put that past in the past? And I'm like, well, no, you got to deal with it before we can put it in the past. So that's kind of a joke at that. Just put the past in the past. But we really do. We need to learn to put the past in the past. Our ultimate example is God the Father, who loves us so much, he put the past in the past. It's buried. Our sins have been carried far away, just like we sang about this morning, never to be mentioned or brought up against us again. How? Why? Keep reading verse 7. According to the riches of his grace. According to the riches, that's a good word to circle, of his grace, G-A-R-C-E, God's riches at Christ's expense. Sin made us poor, but grace makes us rich in the things that really matter. Grace is God's unmerited favor. God's riches at Christ's expense. It's grace. It's free. It's unmerited. You didn't earn it. It's not because you're so good looking or smart or sweet or cool or well behaved. I enjoyed being in Sunday school this morning. If you're not coming to Sunday school, come at 9:30. We have great classes for everybody. Today I went to the middle school class. And my teacher this morning was a boy from my youth group 10 years ago, who's now a man, who's in the middle school's teacher, Justin. Justin is my son's teacher. I had Justin when he was in the youth group, and it feels kind of good to sit in a class and be taught by somebody who I was teaching 10, 15 years ago, who's now teaching my son each week. And they had a great group in there, and they were very well behaved, evidently because I was there. But whatever, they were great. And they threw out some stuff that we can't talk about in here. And if anything weird comes up at dinner, parents, just understand, funny things come up in middle school boys' classes sometimes. But they were talking about the tongue. And we looked at the Ten Commandments, which is on the wall in there. And we talked about, you know, honoring God, honoring your parents, not lying. And all that. But at the end of the day, the last thing we want to do, the last thing Justin wants to do is say, hey, boys, if you'll behave and say nice things and never say a bad word, God will love you and save you and let you go to heaven one day. That's not the message we're teaching here. What we're really saying is he has forgiven you of everything you ever said, everything you ever will say. You're a child of the king. Act like it. And king's children, princes and princesses, don't go around with potty mouth, making their dad look stupid, which is another word we shouldn't use. Making their dad look bad. Are you with me? It's grace. We've been redeemed. He purchased us. He's given us everything we need according to his riches. That's pretty cool. Now, what will matter 100 years from now? What will matter a million years from now? Let me tell you what won't matter. Your checking account, your 401k, your how big or small a house or car, property, possessions, all that stuff are not going to matter for diddly squat 100 years from now, much less a million years from now. We need to live for what's important. This is what's important. Every person has an eternal soul that will be in heaven or hell 1 million years from now. If you have the assurance of heaven, you're rich. That's what I'm trying to tell you. No matter what you've been through, whether you've been abandoned or forsaken or hurt or whatever the heartache is, just understand, in the million-year plan, even the 100-year plan, it's going to be okay. You've been redeemed. You've been purchased. You've been accepted, predestined, embraced, all those other words I'm forgetting there. Accepted, embraced, forgiven, chosen, thank you, predestined. So that's a pretty cool thing. Stop wasting time. Stop wasting energy. Stop wasting money on things that don't matter. Now, you have to buy food to eat to live. You have to have a house to live in. Please don't feel persecuted because you have a nice house. God bless you if you have a nice house. Invite people over and tell them about Jesus. If you have a nice car, put that guy in there and drive him to church with it. Use the resources God gave you to share this wonderful thing. Now, verse 8, and in closing, verse 8, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight. What did he lavish upon us in all wisdom and insight? His grace. His grace. He lavished upon us. He poured out his love and his kindness on the ones that he adopted and chose and accepted. And we know about his grace from other passage. His grace is, say it with me, his grace is sufficient. I like that one. And I put that in my notes today, but you know what? That's not where he's going. When I think of sufficient, I think of a good enough pair of shoes. I think of a good enough, I don't know, whatever. Good enough car to get around. Think of the minimum. It's good enough. God will meet your needs. His grace is sufficient, which is true. But here, look at verse 8 again. It's saying more than that, isn't it? He has, say that word out loud with me. He has lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight. He's lavished his grace on us. Think about any possible usage of the word lavish. I don't know why, and this is way out in left field, but I think of like Liberace. Remember that guy? The fur coats and the rings. It's like, good grief. Lavished. A lavish lifestyle. Now, forget about that guy because we need to get back on the Bible. But I think of a way nicer car than I need. I think of a way nicer wife than I need. See, God lavished me. This is where we're going, okay? 16 years ago, on Friday, Elizabeth and I celebrated our 16th anniversary. And all those years ago, well, 2 years before that, I fell madly in love with her and lavished all my love on her. And after running away from it for a good little while, she sort of accepted it a little bit, and then she learned to love me. But I look at God's blessing in my life when it comes to that as him lavishing grace on me. He didn't just give me the minimum, the sufficient. Are you following what I'm trying to say? We are the object of his attention, his affection. He loves us. He lavishes. The literal meaning, here's the literal meaning for that word, superabundance, which I'm not even sure is a real word, but it's written in the commentary. Superabundance, excess, abundance. It's exorbitant, extravagant, overwhelming love and grace for the object of God's affection, which is you and me. How cool is that? How cool is that? So somehow, God the Son loves me even more than I love Elizabeth. And Ephesians 5 talks about that. Our relationship with God the Son, the bride, us, the church, and the bridegroom. He lavishes his love on us. God the Father looks at his sons and daughters the way you look at your sons and daughters and your grandchildren with this lavishing love and grace. God the Holy Spirit literally lives within you. He lavished his grace, his love on us on the cross 2,000 years ago, but it's real today too. Redemption happened for some of you. It was made available a long time ago. You were chosen a long time ago, but it became real in your life at a certain point, and you appreciate it. And some of us are real excited about the Lord for a little while. But then we just sort of fade away and it becomes ho-hum. And some of us get just totally tied up and we chain ourselves down and you need to be set free, even Christians. I was listening to Unshackled on the radio last night. Anybody ever listen to Unshackled? Cool show. But this is a man who went to jail for a lot of crimes, met a preacher's daughter. She shared the gospel with him. He got saved. He married the preacher's daughter. He's been set free. He never went back to prison other than to preach in it. And I love that story because that physical bondage and being released from being in prison. But it's so much more than just a physical prison. Some of us are locked up with chains. Even Christians have allowed ourselves to be locked up into stuff. And today I'm just saying, be set free. In the name of Jesus, be set free. And even the middle schoolers were smart enough to know that you need some accountability. Have someone ask you, what are you doing? How's that going in your life? Don't let yourself be willingly locked up and chained into stuff that drags you down. As a follower of Christ, be set free. Be redeemed afresh. Embrace it. Enjoy it. And share it. There's one little story I want to share before we pray that I hope it's not so trivial that it loses its meaning. But we were looking at the Karate Kid the other day, the old Karate Kid. And I'm not, like, endorsing or anything, but cute show. But what the thing that makes you remember the story 30 years after it was put out in the movies is you have this boy, Daniel LaRusso, who has a great mom, a little bit overbearing type mom, no dad. And he doesn't have any friends, and he's in a new town, he's getting beaten up. And then what happens? He meets Mr. Miyagi. Don't we all need a Mr. Miyagi? This guy, now there's no Christian message. I mean, I think he was like, I don't know what he was into, but it wasn't Jesus. But the point of the thing is, Mr. Miyagi was like a father figure to him. Mr. Miyagi accepted him, and he taught him, you know, wax on, wax off. And there's such a good principle there. We feel like we're wasting our time until Mr. Miyagi throws you the keys to the car you've been waxing and lavished on Daniel LaRusso. Mr. Miyagi lavished his love for this boy. He taught him karate. He taught him how to defend himself. He gave him his car. He took him into his home. And the best scene in that whole movie is toward the end of it, where the boy looks up to Mr. Miyagi and he says, "You're the best friend I ever had." And that's so cool. That is a minuscule example of what we have with God. He's the best friend we ever had. And Lord Jesus is the best friend we ever had. He accepted us. He loved us. He gave us everything we needed. And it wasn't just something you decided years ago when you got saved. Or maybe for some of you, today could be your day. And that's great. But our tendency is just leave it in the past. And think, well, I got God's grace. I've been redeemed. No, you need his grace new every, it's fresh every morning. You need it every day. And some of us need to be redeemed. We need to be set free from some things. And the invitation today is understand it. Embrace God's grace toward you. If you need to be saved, if you need to be given eternal life, just receive it today. He loves you. But on a daily basis, after that, embrace it. Enjoy God's rich love for you as his adopted child, his friend, the object of his affection. Share his love. It could be a note. It could be taking someone to lunch. Take that love, that grace that you've been given. It could be a hug, a text, maybe a visit, a gift. Just one word, a simple word, a prayer, a gesture. Share his love. Would you do that? Would you pray about that right now as we come to a close? We've only gotten through two verses today, but they are profound. And this is how you become a Christian. This is the Bible telling you how you can be saved, how you can be redeemed. So first of all, if you need to receive Christ into your life today and be saved, just pray and invite him in right now. What we do right now is called an invitation. We are inviting you to do business with God. Christians, you're invited to embrace the love God has for you. And all this self-hate and all this judging everybody else, forget all that. Just receive God's forgiveness and afresh. Maybe plan on getting a little accountability or maybe you need to identify the thing that has you in bondage and just say, Lord, nobody else knows about this or very few people know this about this, but you know. And listen, he's the best friend you'll ever have. He's not going to smack you. He's not going to, you're saved. You're his son. He's not an abusive father. Some of you experience that, so it messes up the whole father-son thing, father-daughter thing. He's the father you wish you had. Just receive that. He wants to help you with it. But back to the core of where we are right now. If you're here and you're the one that just needs to be born again, you need to be saved, I encourage you to receive what Christ did for you today. He died on that cross. He shed his blood to forgive you of your sins. He will give you grace that you just couldn't even believe. It's lavish. It's awesome. It's life-changing. So I invite you right now, the invitation is for you to receive Christ. And I'm going to lead you through the prayer, because I feel very strongly convicted to do that today. Maybe someone's listening on the internet or on our television show, or maybe you're sitting right here and you just need Jesus in your life and you want to be set free. You want to be born again, promised heaven, to be made a child of the King. That happens at a point in time. And it happens when you finally surrender, which is a song we're going to sing in a minute, surrender to him. So would you invite Christ into your life right now? With our heads bowed, with everybody kind of praying and minding your own business, don't worry about anybody else. Where you are, ask yourself, do I know for sure I'm on my way to heaven, that I've been redeemed? If not, man, nail it down right now. Ask the Lord Jesus to come into your life. Trust him completely to save you. Believe in what he did for you. And believe doesn't just mean believe it happened. Believe in the sense of put all your eggs in his basket. Trust him completely with it. Ask him to save you. Let me give you some words to pray. And you don't have to pray them out loud, and you don't have to pray these exact words, but I want you to think through it and talk about it to God in your heart, because he's listening to you right now. And he's awesome. He can listen to 7 billion people all at the same time. It's amazing. He's God. He's infinite. So right now, say, God, I need you in my life desperately. I'm tired of trying to make it on my own. I can't make it on my own. I'm embarrassed over the sin in my life. I'm convicted because of the sin in my life. And God, you know every single one of them, and I just ask you, you'd forgive me for them. Every one of those sins, please forgive me. Through the power of your holy blood, Lord Jesus, please wash away my sins. I trust you. I give my life to you. I give my heart to you right now. I'm throwing out a lot of words, and I don't want to get ahead of anybody. And I'm here to talk with you if you want to pray after or pray now during the invitation. But right now, where you are, in this quiet moment, just ask the Lord Jesus Christ to come into your life and totally transform you and save you. I give my life to you, Lord Jesus. I will follow you. I trust you. With nobody looking, I wonder, did somebody just pray and invite Christ into your life? If you were serious about it, listen, I'm not going to put you on the spot or anything like that, or call on you or go get you or anything like that, but I want to rejoice with you. And if you were serious about it, man, the first tiny little acknowledgement of it is right now. Yes, I just prayed and invited Christ in my life. Would you raise your hand where I can see it? Raise your hand nice and tall. Don't let me miss you. I want to rejoice with you. Anybody like that today? Yes, I just prayed and invited Christ into my life. Oh, man, that's great. I see a little buddy. Anybody else? Yes. Yes, I just gave my heart to Jesus. I asked him to save me. Anybody like that? Anybody else? Okay. If you want to talk to somebody about it, come forward and talk with me about it. If you want to spend some time alone at the altar just dealing with things, do that. If you want to just come and celebrate and take a few minutes to rejoice in the incredible, infinite, unconditional love of Christ who lavished his grace upon you, that's what this invitation is all about. Oh, God, I surrender. I surrender that thing to you. I surrender myself to you. So, Lord, I pray that you would help us to do that. Help me to do that. Move right now in our time of invitation, Lord Jesus. Please do that through the power of your Holy Spirit. Help us to be obedient. Help us to be responsive and sensitive to your leading in our lives. And Lord, help the answer to be yes, sir, before you even ask the question, before you even give the command. Yes, sir, Lord, I surrender in Jesus' name. Let's stand and sing. Come as God leads you.
I'm giving you my heart and all that is within. I lay it all down for the sake of you, my King. I'm giving you my dreams, I'm laying down my rights, I'm giving up my pride for the promise of new life. And I surrender all to you.
Austin. Jim Austin's going to pray for us and dismiss us in just a moment. And we're going to remind you to meet Christy and them up here for the Vacation Bible School meeting after church. And he's going to give you an update on Crossover Part 2 and then pray for us.
So I was a little bit jealous about the report from Wise. That Families on Mission is a great missionary opportunity for you, and I hope that I and you will be able to take part in that next year. On June the 7th, we went to Baltimore to help prepare a transformation center, a place where the folks at Streetlight Community Church are going to be reaching out to the needs of a pretty desperate part of the city. And one of the things that happened is that as we were working in the gymnasium, you see a lot of little kids coming and sticking their heads in to see what was going on, thinking maybe I can play in this gym someday. And they can play in that gym someday, and there'll be men and women from the Streetlight Fellowship there that'll be sharing the gospel with them and be mentoring them. And you can be a part. You can stand alongside the folks there at Streetlight as they prepare to open this transformation center. Who knows? One of those little kids that was coming by and sticking their head in the door looking at the gymnasium, maybe a future Pat Fiordelise. Maybe a future Sunday school teacher, maybe a future evangelist. And so we have an opportunity to be a part of that. This Saturday, we're leaving at 6:30 in the morning. We are asking you to bring your own lunch with you. We'll eat on the way back. We'll do a lot of grungy work while we're up there. And we'll have a lot of good fellowship amongst ourselves and with the folks from Bermuda Baptist will be going back with us, and with the folks from Streetlight. You can sign up in the hall, and while you're there, you can look at the Families on Mission pictures from Wise, and we'll make sure that you have all the information you need. There is an information sheet there. There is also a medical release form which you need to have in case there's an accident, so we can get you the medical attention that you need. So we hope you will do that. We hope those who are going to be working in Vacation Bible School will first go pick up their children and then come back here to the church, to the front of the sanctuary for a short five minutes meeting in preparation for Vacation Bible School this week. This has been a really intense time at our church and opportunities to share and to minister. If you haven't had one of those opportunities yet, it's not too late to be part of Vacation Bible School this year, and it's not too late to be part of Crossover Baltimore. Let's pray together. Almighty God, you are truly the God of amazing and lavish grace, and through your grace, we can experience real peace in our lives. Father, in this very room today, there are people whose hearts are broken, whose families are in turmoil, whose jobs are a mess, whose relationships are very difficult. So, Father, I ask you to lavish your grace on this sanctuary this morning, to lavish your grace on every heart that's in this place today, and bring your peace, the peace that we cannot understand. Bring your peace into our hearts and our lives. We are so grateful that we can approach you with our greatest and deepest needs and with the pain that we experience in our life. And we are so grateful that as our loving Heavenly Father, you always put your arm around us and pull us close to you and remind us how much you love us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.